festivities for today. Before I came to Austin, I lived in upstate New York, and I would go to the New York City Futurist Group. They had a large city to draw on, and they would occasionally have some well-known speakers come and speak at their monthly meetings. But the most common format of the meetings was actually to draw on the local population expertise. And they literally had a topic picked, and they would give people 6 minutes to talk on it. They try and get 5, 6, 7 people to come in and give 6-minute presentations on it. It's really actually a challenge to do something creative and interesting in just 6 minutes. It's very hard to do. So that was always interesting to watch, to see how people cram things into 6 minutes as much as they could. We don't have quite the population of New York City to draw on, so we'll give people 10 to 15 minutes to talk on our little panel discussion here. And it's not really a panel discussion in the sense we're all sitting up here in front. We just have 4 speakers who are going to give their own version of the topic tonight. So let me introduce Joyce Joya, who is agreed to be our moderator. If you don't know Joyce, she's strategic business futurist, president, CEO of the Herman Group, the first road warrior of the year named by USA Today, author of the Herman Trend Alert, author of 5 books, certified speaking professional, certified management consultant, and so on and so forth. Joyce, we're glad to have you here. Thank you very much for agreeing to moderate the group.
I've got to stay in the middle so the camera, yeah.
You're going to have to move it, John, when your speakers start, because thus they would be standing in front of their slides, okay? Good evening, everyone. Before we begin, I'd like to share with you a conversation that I had and some news. You probably don't know that the World Future Society, as of July 31st, will have a new president. And that new president is a wonderful woman named Amy Zalman, who most recently has been working with the War College in, in Washington, D.C. And I share this with you to let you know that Amy and I had a conversation about the chapters. And one of the things that we agreed on is that the chapters are a very important aspect of the national organization. And she is committed to supporting the chapters, and probably that will be through me, since I'm the board member, the national board member, with WFS, who is assigned to liaison with the chapters. So I wanted to share that with you before I begin. I'm privileged today to be moderating 4 fascinating speakers, 3 fascinating speakers. Mike Ignatowski, Paul Schumann, and John Duncanson. And if you'll tell me the order, is this the correct order?
That was a quick order, but you want to do Carrie first?
Oh, Carrie. Carrie has an announcement.
2 announcements.
2 announcements. Okay, take it away, Carrie.
Very exciting news. Last year, most of you probably know that Central Texas World Future Society and World Future Society were both in-kind sponsors to our mini-trans conference, our second mini-trans conference in 2013.
Did have first.
This year, 2014, I called up Jeff Cornish yesterday and told him, wow, I understand that you're looking for sponsors for the July World Future Society conference up in Orlando. John and I and David Snyder are giving a master of course there. And so we're going to both be there. We're looking to get you guys involved with our Mini Trends Conference 2013 again. 2014 is on September 26th. We have several people here in the town that are involved in the Mini Trends Conference. We'll talk some more. And he's agreed, my understanding, and he's sometimes hard to understand, is that we're going to be sponsoring them, the World Future Society, and they're going to be sponsoring, along with the Central Texas World Future Society Arbor Nutrients Conference. So we're going to be trading sponsorships. So it's really exciting that that's going to happen. The second thing is, I hope that's okay with you guys. The second thing, basically what I'm going to do is, I'm going to be there the whole time. John is only going to be there part of the time, but I think that we'll get a booth and we'll really try to push it. And if any of you guys are there, maybe you can help me stand at the booth, and maybe David Snyder can help. But we'll be pushing people coming to Austin to come to the Mini Trends Conference here, so that, you know, we'll have some push from the national and the international people. The second thing is, I think I've got a commitment from Brett Hurt to be one of our keynotes. David Snyder, who of World Future Society fame, is going to be our morning keynote. But I think I have Brett Hurt agreeing to be the afternoon one. We have tried to get Jim Truchard. I finally said today, I wrote the secretary and said I need an answer by tomorrow. She wrote back she couldn't do it. So I linked in with Brett Hurt and said, I'd like to connect with you because I'd like to invite you to be our keynote in September 26th. Can you answer back so I can email you an invitation? He wrote back and he said, it looks like I can do it. Send me the information. So anyway, I'm really excited about that. So you guys will be involved with that too. And hopefully we can all get lots of business and lots of contacts out of that. Thank you.
Thank you, Carrie. Our first speaker is Mike Ignatowski. Mike is currently fellow design engineer at AMD, and his work is in advanced memory systems and high performance computing. Prior to that, Mike spent several years with IBM, and most recently was at the IBM Watson Research Center as a research senior technical staff person. Did I get all that right?
Very good.
His topic today is an overview of a NASA-sponsored article predicting collapse and various reviews. Take it away, Mike.
Thanks, Joyce. There was an article that came out back in March this year on this topic, which created a lot of interest. Some people were very enthusiastic about it. Appeared in a lot of newspapers, a lot of blogs, a lot of online journals, and some people were very critical of it. A lot of emotions on both sides, but I thought, this is something that we should address because it's actually such an interesting topic. And the title was The Collapse of Civilization, or not, depending on how you want to interpret the results. I'm going to stand on this side here. So I'm going to give you an introduction to the paper, some of the claims it made, and then we're going to go on to three other speakers who are going to talk different views on the same topic. This is the paper that started off a lot of this interest, Human and Nature Dynamics. It's published March 19th of this year, and it was partially funded by NASA. And I'll tell you about what the paper said, then I'll tell you about the two false statements on this first slide. So the introduction of the paper is written by three academics. They talked about the fall of various societies. They gave a list of quite a few. They basically made the argument that this is the common fate of societies. They will eventually fall and collapse. It happened throughout history, and there's no reason to believe that this could happen again to our society. So they had this computer model they worked on. It started off very simple. They're familiar with the predator-prey model. Simple set of equations. It looks at the balance between predators and prey. And I always think of this as wolves and rabbits on an island someplace. As the wolf population grows, it starts eating most of the rabbits, the rabbit population declines. Then the wolf population also declines through starvation, which then allows the rabbit population to go back up. And it's a cyclical thing. And this is a very common behavior in population dynamics. If you change some of the parameters to this, for example, if the wolves reproduce more slowly and the population grows slowly, instead of being cyclical, it kind of smoothly goes to a sustainable level. If the wolf population reproduces very quickly, then these swings could be much more violent, and you can actually get a situation where the whole population collapses and all the rabbits are killed. So they took this and added a lot of details to this and tried to apply it to human societies. Now, I'll try and explain these charts real quickly on the condition that you don't ask a lot of technical questions. Look at the shape of the curve, the pretty colors. Don't ask me to explain the values on the axes at all. But they looked at a set of people, in this case they call them commoners, workers, and how they impacted on nature. I like to think of this as, say it's a small village that got most of their food from a lake, a large lake, and this was the number of fish remaining in the lake. As the population increases, the number of fish reduced a little bit, but eventually you reach some stable carrying capacity where the population of people and the amount of fish in the lake were in nice equilibrium. And they also added to this model this thing called wealth. Think of this as saved wealth, as in the population learned how to smoke and preserve the fish so they could save some for lean times. And they looked at a bunch of different scenarios. So here's one where the number of people, the commoners, actually went well above the carrying capacity of the lake and kind of decimated the number of fish in the lake. But they had this big wealth saved up of preserved fish in their huts, so they could keep growing even though there's not much fish in the actual lake, and just living on this saved wealth. But eventually that ran out, and they had no fish left in the lake, no saved wealth, and the population just crashed from starvation. And one of the lessons they were trying to show here is if a civilization goes way above its carrying capacity because it's utilizing some sort of stored or saved wealth, peak oil, results can be disastrous when you run out of that saved wealth. And now they started adding more complexity to this model of civilization. They added non-workers. And in their mind, these were people like managers and hedge fund managers, bankers, and so on, who didn't actually do work. They didn't actually pull any fish out of the lake. So you get things like this, the number of workers were somewhat reduced because now you had to support all the non-workers too. In their mind, these were the takers, and the common workers were the makers. Interesting twist on this.
How come the carrying capacity is so high?
I think it's this plus this is the carrying capacity. Then they added inequality to this. So these non-workers, the elites in society, the hedge fund managers, what would happen if they started consuming a lot more than the common workers? And you get situations like this where now, think of this as a measure of how much resources each group is consuming. The elites ended up consuming a large portion of resources in the society. And in fact, this chart kind of forced the elites to limit themselves. Otherwise, the number of elites would just keep growing and they consume everything. So you get a stable situation, but only if there's some constraints on the amount the elite people can consume. And if you don't put those constraints on, it actually runs up to a peak real quickly. And the only way they can show an interesting graph is, let's keep the elites very low at the beginning, very small number of them. Then the commoners can grow, start exploiting nature, and things look stable for a while, but eventually the elites will continue to grow, and they'll reach a point where they just start consuming all the results, all the resources, there's no constraints put on them. The commoners will have all the resources taken by the elites, they'll go downhill, nobody's fishing anymore, the elites can still keep going because they're now living on the accumulated saved wealth until that runs out, and then they crash too. And they say if you don't put constraints on the elites, the computer model keeps predicting this type of pattern, and there's no easy way around that. So they sent the article to the Guardian, NASA-funded study, industrial civilization headed for irreversible collapse, and they did quite a big deal with this in one of their online blogs, got a lot of attention, and spread to other media. New York Post, NASA predicts the end of Western civilization. Here's how NASA thinks society will collapse. The Daily Caller, online journal, NASA-funded study. The way to save Western civilization from collapse is communism. Limiting the elites. So NASA finally responded and said, oh, by the way, we did not really fund this study. We funded some people to do these mathematical tools. They took them completely separate from us and applied them to this study. We do not sponsor this. We do not support it. It does not endorse or condemn it. We're just, it's nothing to do with this. It's nothing to do with us, folks. This is separate. So it wasn't really a NASA-sponsored study. And it also turns out it wasn't a published study. They did submit it to a referee journal, but nothing has happened yet. No decisions have been made. The only way it was published is they sent a copy of it to the Guardian, and the Guardian newspaper published it online. So a lot of people jumped on this criticism. There's no evidence that elite consumption caused ancient societies to collapse. You have no supporting data for this. In fact, there's no historical empirical data at all in the model. It's just a bunch of computer equations. And what about technology improvements? That's not factored at all. And they tried to address this, but just caused more complaints. And some of the attacks actually got personal. They pointed out the lead author on this paper was actually just a grad student. And you shouldn't trust that at all. And then the author shut back saying, if you get to the point where you're starting to personally attack the authors instead of their ideas, you know you might be in a losing situation in terms of the ideas. But what I thought was eventually a good summary is they point out empires rise and fall, but civilizations nowadays seldom collapse. States and kingdoms collapse, but advanced societies generally just reach states of declining. So England, once the most powerful nation in the world, they didn't collapse, they just declined somewhat. Before England, France was the most powerful state in the world, they didn't collapse, they declined somewhat. Before that, the Roman Empire, 300 years of gradual declining after its peak. China has been through various peaks and valleys 4,000 years now. But a lot of people point out that one common thing through all this is that the overall human standard of living conditions throughout the world on the average continue to decrease. So there's
continue to increase,
yes. So there is a lot of reason for optimism, even though individual societies will go up and down and empires will rise and fall. Overall, the course of human history is continuously upward, regardless of these predictions. So that is kind of the summary of it. Is there any questions about the paper itself? It's available online. There's no word yet if actually can get published in a referee journal at all. But we'll see what happens. I think there's been enough criticism. People are probably going to be a little leery about actually publishing in their journal.
What organization originally did the work?
There's a collection of three academics that did it.
Oh.
No organization. And they didn't get paid for it, I guess. Or anyone else.
There is an organization that covered the publication, that basically in a blog. They published this in a blog.
Yes.
And there was an organization, I forgot what the name was, that they had associated with that. It was probably a voluntary situation.
That's
a very good summary.
Let me set up the next one.
John?
And they
are you okay to speak, or do you want to? Hmm?
Yes, we should clap.
Yes.
Okay.
John, wait a minute. I need to introduce you. Stand by.
Okay,
well, while you're getting that, yes, John.
There's a basic thesis that you came up in your explain all this, that if more people live the good life, then you overdo the resources and get will wipe away, and that's why civilization collapses. Is that the basic thesis?
Their thesis was if resources get overutilized beyond carrying capacity, and particularly if there's great inequality in society that enables the resource consumption to keep going above the carrying capacity for at least the elites, they both factors together. The inequality and the overconsumption results.
Consumption beyond production.
Consumption beyond, yeah. Unsustainable consumption.
Yeah.
Both together result in the collapse.
No, actually, okay. I just read a book in macro history of China. The main thing is look at the from a macro wheel to look at the ups and downs in the Chinese history. It's about 300-year dynasty. The founder done a good job, killed everybody else, and set up his own empire. Then the follower, the son and grandson, and down the train, they overconsume and also they mismanage the situation as the situation changes. And one bad thing is when they start consuming, but they don't know how to tax. So they set up a good system in the beginning, 20 years ago, and by the end of the dynasty, they don't know how to collect money, finance, all the things they try to do, the military and all the disasters, the due to nature. You know, people are flooding and also dry. And
they can't respond if they
yeah,
don't
they
have the funds.
And also,
right.
You know.
Makes sense. Okay. Thank you very much, Bob. Our second speaker is John Duncanson. John is currently Vice President of R&D for Falcon Day Consulting. They handle government contracts and usability analysis. John has 26 years of experience in software development, 5 years of experience in software usability and website usability, and 15 years experience in software process improvement. He's also Vice President of the Austin Software Process Improvement Network and their former webmaster for 5 years. John's topic is A Choice of Catastrophes, a very short summary of Isaac Asimov's book, A Choice of Catastrophes, supplemented with updated material from other sources, more of a physicist's viewpoint than the socioeconomic slant of the NASA report. Thank you, John. Yes, please.
John, do you want me to advance your slides? Do you need me to advance your slides? Rather than
that would be helpful.
Huh?
That would be helpful, yes.
Okay.
Okay.
When you're ready.
Yes.
Oops.
Sure.
What just happened?
What is this?
Which one? This one?
Yeah.
Oh, thanks.
Right.
Okay, ready?
Okay,
nope.
Yes.
No. We're not ready.
No. Good. Right on.
What happened?
It's on this side.
Oh.
The plug is on this side.
No, not that. It's the other one.
The other one.
Oh.
You disturbed it with your cell phone.
Oh.
Yeah, so take your cell phone out.
Here you go.
Okay. Oh. Sorry. Oh my.
F5. No?
I didn't touch anything.
There
Thank
it is.
Thank you, Mike.
Okay, now.
Okay, we'll just leave it.
Don't
It'll
touch
go
it.
Away. I promise. See? Okay.
All right, now. Also in my background is that my degrees are in chemistry and chemical physics. So what I'm going to present is, like I said, a physicist's slant on things. One of the techniques that physicists used for a loosely defined problem or a problem that he hasn't got an answer for yet is to put limits or boundaries on that problem. And so that's also part of what I will be doing here. Now here's a very short bibliography. It's just some of the many, many, many books you can read about catastrophes and collapse of civilization, and how civilizations rose up and so forth. So Jared Diamond is a very important author, Michael Rupert. In fact, he passed away just a few months ago. And Richard Heinberg has written several books on the problem of running out of oil. Now, it's just a very interesting coincidence that a few weeks before Mike sent out the notice, I had picked up this book, Isaac Asimov's A Choice of Catastrophes, and started reading it. So when Mike announced the topic of tonight's session, he said, wow, this will really fit into that. So what Asimov has done is he has defined five levels of catastrophe. First class is death of the universe. Civilization will definitely end when the universe is gone. Solar system becomes uninhabitable. Earth becomes uninhabitable. But the solar system still survives. Just humans die out, but still life on Earth survives. And then humans survive, but civilization doesn't. And I've added a sixth class that I'll show in a minute. So in the first class, death of the universe, all matter is going to end up being pulled into black holes. And we're in an unbounded expansion called the Big Rip. Just everything will get torn apart. The probability of that happening is 100%. It's not preventable. Impact is total annihilation. Time scale, though, is trillions of years. So recovery is impossible. But it's something we don't need to worry about.
That's good.
Second level is solar system becomes uninhabitable. Collisions of Earth with another, that should be a star, black hole, or a rogue planet. Or supernovas or quasars irradiate Earth with gamma rays. They are going to be very low probability events. They're not preventable. The Earth could be thrown out of orbit, or these gamma radiations would destroy the atmosphere. Time scale means to billions of years, and again, recovery is impossible. The Earth becomes uninhabitable. There are a bunch of other possibilities I list down here, but the one important one is that the sun's output is going to increase steadily over the next millions of years. And so it's virtually certain, it's not preventable. What will happen is over the next about 500 million years to a billion years, the oceans will dry up and all that water will be vaporized and eventually just blown away by the solar wind, so there'll be no water for it to support life. And again, recovery is impossible after that. One interesting sub-fact is that is when you compare a half a billion years to the 3.5 billion years that life has been on Earth, this amounts to 15% of the time that life has existed. So in other words, life on Earth is like 85% through its tenure. Okay, next.
Don't you want to talk about this? The other possibilities, or do we not have time?
We don't have time. But like I said, this is a teaser.
Yep.
And those will be subjects for
got it.
Wait, no, a year from now when I can do a full length talk.
Good.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be a year from now, but go ahead.
Right, okay. Humans die out. You have a massive volcano eruption. There was a massive one 250 million years ago that most of Siberia turned into one huge volcano and destroyed 90% of the life at that time. There was a massive volcano eruption. They now think it's in the Indonesia area about 70,000 years ago, that when they analyze the DNA of humans, they find that the human population had shrunk to like a few thousand about 70,000 years ago. So the Homo sapiens came real close to extinction back then. Another possibility is incurable disease or pandemics that, medicine has not been able to come up with any countermeasures to. That could wipe out the human race. And finally, total thermonuclear war is one that was a big concern from the 50s through the 80s and so forth. So probabilities for those are possible. It's now kind of a low probability now that we've reduced a lot of the numbers of nuclear weapons. That's the impact. And the time scale for each of these is 100,000 years, 100 to 1,000 years, or 50 to 100 years. But whenever these things happen, I recall the quote from Robert A. Heinlein, a very famous science fiction novelist. There are always survivors. So even in these drastic things, like I said, from that massive volcano eruption, there were a few thousand survivors. Okay. All right. Level 5, humans survive, but civilization doesn't. One scenario is depletion of all renewable resources, and there are many more, which I'm going to list on the next slide. Oops. Oh, back.
Page up.
What? I'm sorry?
Page up.
Okay.
So, non-renewable resources, by their definition, when they're used up, they're gone. So, probability of that is 100%. It doesn't seem to be preventable because depletion is driven by economics. Oil companies are going to be selling oil as long as oil is cheap and they've got a plenty of supply. And the population demands energy to be, the population is driving the depletion of non-renewable resources. And that's one of the factors that was in the model that Mike talked about. One of the impact is that it's going to be a scramble to find substitute materials. There's going to be wars fought over scarce non-renewable resources, and so forth. World War II, the reason Japan attacked us at Pearl Harbor was because they do not have any natural oil resources. They needed to get the oil from Indonesia. They wanted to take over the Indonesian oil fields. And to get to Indonesia, they had to go through the Philippines, which the U.S. owned at that time. So they needed to negate the U.S.'s naval power in the Pacific. Hence, let's bomb all of the ships of the U.S. that are sitting in Pearl Harbor. So that's how. So World War II, from that side, was started because of resources. So as these resources run out, we're going to see more and more of this. It's really worrisome that there's a huge reservoir of recently discovered natural resources underneath Afghanistan. What's going to happen to all those resources? Who gets to control it? It's going to be an interesting question. All right, so some of these resources we're going to see running out in the next 30 years, but some others that may take a few years, 1,000 years before we run out of others. And recovery, only if we can transition to 100% renewable resources society. Okay.
Are you saying you think there's 100% possibility of civilization collapse because of this?
No, I'm saying there's 100% probability that we will run out of natural resources, non-renewable resources. Like I said, the recovery here, if we can get to 100% renewable resources, then civilization can continue. One of the books in my bibliography, there's several books that talk about, will the industrial society survive after oil is all gone and fossil fuels are all gone? So that's an open question. And it'll be something interesting to study and talk about. Now, I added a sixth level of catastrophe. In other words, regional civilization collapse. It's not in Asimov's list, but it's a case that so many of the people, when they talk about threats to civilization, they are threats that will affect one regional area, but not another. You know, the collapse of the Mayans didn't affect the growth of civilization in Europe, for example. Overpopulation followed by a population collapse is one scenario, and I'm going to list a whole bunch more in a moment. But we can be darn sure that we're going to go through these cyclic civilization ups and downs. So the overpopulation, that is a problem that I don't see a solution to. That it's driven by human nature, the desire to reproduce. Again, it's those predator-prey slides that Mike showed going through cycles like that. We just haven't hit our first cycle yet. And so that time scale is 50 to 100 years. Like I said, population's going to cycle up and down. Okay. All right, so here's some other possibilities. Climate change for the runaway greenhouse effect, drought, depletion of the ozone layer, depletion of drinkable fresh water, what the computer people call a singularity, and what I call artificial intelligence singularity, to distinguish it from other singularities, is when 30 or 40 years from now, computers are going to be more intelligent than humans. And what happens after that is still open to wild conjectures. Another possibility is someone generates a microorganism against which you have no defense. And poor education on a global scale. If we could get the whole world educated up to approximately the level that we have in Western society, a whole lot of troubles would go away. Next one. And thing that frightens me now that, for example, Roadrunner email has been down for the past week. What happens if we get a global system computer crash? And we've got terrorist groups.
What's been down for the last week?
Pardon? Yes.
What's been down for the last week?
Oh, Roadrunner email, Time Warner Cable.
Oh, okay.
Unfortunately, I'm one of the victims of that. So we've got drug cartels that lots of money, terrorists that got lots of money. Organized cybercrime and failed states. So these are just some of the possibilities of things that attack civilization. And so a whole hour lectures could be done on each one of these individually. So when we talk about the decline of civilization, we want to ask, how do you define civilization? How do you define levels of civilization? When we talk about natural resources, we need to talk about energy use needed to sustain civilization and how much you need to sustain a sustainable level of civilization. And another natural resource problem is that 40 years of known reserves of lead. What happens when we run out of that? All right, the non-reserve, this is, like Mike said, this is a teaser talk, so this is to be filled in later.
Okay.
All right, next one. Okay, now, John Berry, one of our members, gave a talk a couple of years ago on, because he's a geologist, and he talked about the depletion of mineral resource. And some of the his talk is available on our homepage on the right under the meeting materials tab. And some of his points were, there are no new frontiers to explore for mining. All of the high-grade ores have been found. The grade of ore is decreasing, and it's increasing cost to get the lower-grade ores processed. A lot of land gets destroyed in that process. But he feels we won't see serious problems until about 2050. Next one. Now, one problem that I find very irking is people talk about, well, we're going to defeat the Malthusian dilemma, that we can continue to support population growth. Now, in Isaac Asimov's book, this was written in 79, he also published an article in Parade magazine around that same time. That was the one that got me interested in this particular calculation. Population growth is proportional to the amount of population. And that makes a geometric progression. It's exponential growth. No physical property can grow exponentially forever. So he calculated for 2% growth every 35 years. You have 50 billion people by 2100, over a trillion by 2280. In 1800 years, the total mass of humanity would exceed the mass of the Earth. And in 5,000 years, which is less than a history of civilization, the mass of humanity would exceed the total mass of the known universe. From this simple physical, like I said, physicists put a limit or boundary on parameters on a problem. This is a proof that population cannot grow forever, and we're guaranteed to have either a level in the population or a drop-off. Like I said, we haven't reached our first cycle in that population cycle model. And another area that when we talk about civilization sustainability that we want to explore is energy use versus civilization level. And you can see through the ages that energy level per capita has always grown up and up and up. So what happens when we run out of fossil fuels? That's a question to think about. And I think that's the last slide.
So what's the good news?
One bit of good news, actually. You had one bullet that said third world nations are going to be much worse off. I just spent 2 weeks in Nepal, trekking in the very rural areas, very steep, where sometimes they had three different languages within a 25-mile radius because not before transportation, and they're self-sufficient.
Mm-hmm. Well,
and I think they're going to be a whole lot better if and when the tipping point comes.
Right.
They are farther to don't have as far to fall.
Yeah, like Heinlein said, they're always survivors. So when Western civilization collapses, these small islands of self-sufficiency are going to survive. And also Nepal has a very enlightened government policy. Instead of measuring gross domestic product, they measure gross domestic happiness.
Bhutan.
One additional really scary point that I don't think you mentioned, and that is the possibility of carbon dioxide runaway, greenhouse effect runaway.
I did have one bullet point on that, the runaway greenhouse effect.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
We end up like Venus. And what's still not known to scientists yet is what is that concentration tipping point, whether we've reached it or not, or whether it's another 100 parts per million still to go.
One threat you didn't mention was politicians.
Which one?
Politicians. You have a list there of things like drug cartels. They have a lot of money, can do dangerous things. Politicians have a lot of money.
And can do very dangerous things.
Right. Yeah, like I said, my emphasis was more on the physical side of things, things that we can define boundaries to, and the whole socioeconomic, political thing, that's a whole big area on itself. Yes, politicians have, in various points in history, have demolished their own civilization.
I have some question about your population growth projection.
Mm-hmm.
I thought currently in the most Western world, it kind of below 1.0 per family children. Like in Hong Kong, 0.7, or in Singapore, maybe they encourage more children.
Right.
Oh, they have baby bonuses in those places.
Yeah.
They pay people for having children.
Well, that's a small island country. But most of Western world are below 1.0.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the only the third world, maybe Indonesia, India, the two that not control yet, but China start control, but they have some problem.
Yeah.
They try to have one child, now they have more male than female. They are a different kind of problem.
Yeah, China has realized that their population can't run forever, can't consume resources forever. They expect to be self-sufficient. So that's part of why they're so deeply into solar energy and the like as well. So they've been trying to stabilize their population. And the Western societies, their population growth, I mean, in the US, population growth has declined except for immigration. And it's really some huge percentage, I don't know, 70 or 80% of population growth in the world since the 1950s has been in the third world countries. So they still haven't, they they still tolerate 10 children living in poverty. And,
well, you see, if the majority move in the city, that they are going to get more entertainment, they don't have time for bedtime activities.
Yeah,
for
them. And they also get better paid, cost more to raise the children.
Yeah, right, right. Yeah. The cost of raising children is very important in the city. Yeah.
All right.
Join me in thanking John. I will now take a very short break so that you can get coffee and pie if you wish.
Take one and pass it down, please.
So, Paul,
yeah,
you got two things you sent me.
Yeah, I want just one without the 350 on it.
One out 350.
Yeah. That one north.
For you? I think
if we can bring it up on the screen without starting, that would be great.
I'm excited.
Yeah.
Oh, this is this.
Just hit the there in the middle. When you're ready.
Paul, you'll tell me when you're ready and I'll
yeah,
have the mic.
Yeah, please let everybody get their coffee. My
daughter has, but I think she's coming in tonight, so I see her. I just went up and talked to them. It was amazing how they had it. Because I'm a nerd. And I would really like to do it one day. I have a computer. I have a computer on my laptop. I can't take notes, but not well.
I might just mention there's a theme I ran into a couple of years ago that ended up in inviting a woman to come and speak to us. She did. Penny Kelly is a psychic who had these visitors who told her about things to come that actually got me involved in writing about this kind of thing as well. And their story was that when the economic collapse occurs, and because with all the guns and gangs and like that, it becomes so difficult to live well, to have food enough to eat and like that, that people become depressed, and by virtue of their depression, their immune systems fall, and they fall prey to ordinary diseases. And there's a 30 to 50% reduction in world population, not as a result of war or genocide or anything, but just because things get so bad that people can't live very well. And that was a whole different scenario than I'd ever thought of.
Very interesting.
All right, I'm ready to go where you are.
Okay. Speaker this evening is Paul Schumann. He's a blogger on a website called Insights and Foresight. He also is affiliated with a company that I believe is yours called Global Advantage. Paul is a multifaceted professional whose expertise embraces the gamut of technology and product development, manufacturing, engineering, and education. He's a business futurist and strategy development consultant who is also a former IBM employee. Over the years, he's developed many seminars and workshops for NTU, NTU being National Technical University. And the largest of these was entitled Leadership in the Interactive Age. Paul will be talking about this strange behavior of a complex system. Complex systems behave in unexpected ways. Take it away, Paul.
I'm going to negate everything you said by saying that I'm now officially retired, so I don't want to do anything. I warn you right from the very beginning, this entire thing I'm going to say is all metaphor. There's absolutely no basis for what I'm going to say, other than it's interesting. And can we draw some parallels? And you can do that as a metaphor, but don't leap to trying to understand the exact nature of what the relationship might be. When I was doing work on complexity science, one of the things that popped up was this thing called a logistic map. And it's a very deceptively looking equation, which is in the handout that I gave you. And it's a simple algebraic equation. It says x sub n plus 1 is equal to r times x sub n times the quantity 1 minus x sub n. So it's a quadratic equation. And it's a very simple quadratic equation. You don't have a handout back
no.
there? All right. Around, but I guess it didn't. Oh, he's the one. He's the resource hog here.
Mini.
What I'm going to show you is this logistic map has a very narrow range of application. The variables for x are between 0 and 1. The values for r, this factor, multiplicative factor, is between 0 and 1. What it turns out is the R really is the measure of the amount of positive feedback that's in the system. The larger the R, the more positive the feedback is, which means that each loop, you would think, would get bigger and bigger in the system. And what I'm going to show you is a video that I put together, by the way, painstakingly after thousands of calculations to be able to show this. I kept trying to figure out how to display this so that people could grasp it. And this is a little simple logistical map where x sub 0 is 0.5, and it's a range of r from 0.1 to 4. Okay, you can start it up. What you're going to see is x sub n on this side and time on the other side. And here we're starting out at 0.4, 0.3, whatever it's growing. And you see that as this is growing, for every value r less than 1, it goes to 0 over time. So it dies out. Then, when you get above 1, now it's at 1.3, you see that it's stable for a very long period of time, and each time you raise the amount of positive feedback in the system, the level goes up, and it continues to rise with time, until it gets to 2. And then it's a completely flat and stable circumstance. When the R gets above 2, you begin to see slight instabilities in the equation. Right here at the beginning now, you're starting to see there's a few little wiggles and waggles. At 2.6, it begins to show some degree of oscillation. It goes a little bit longer, and when it gets up to 3, a very interesting thing happens when it reaches 3. This is 3 coming up. 3, it's now split into 2 levels. And as you increase the amount of positive feedback, those levels grow wider and wider apart. Then they split into 4s and 8s. And by the time you reach a little over 3.6, it's completely chaotic. There's no pattern in it at all. and you're anywhere from 0 to 1. When it reaches 4, it goes to 0 again. And so you have total collapse. Now, if we can show this again, we can come back and talk a little bit about it once you understand what you're seeing. There's several metaphors you can draw from this. We often wonder why some civilizations just never seem to quite make it over the hump. And those are the ones that have a feedback, positive feedback of less than 1. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. It is. It was. I pressed it.
Slow for some reason.
Huh?
Okay.
It's creeping.
Okay. So these are civilizations or pockets, could be neighborhoods, could actually even be metaphor for an individual. Maybe as somebody who's disadvantaged within the society that doesn't have enough positive feedback to actually make it over the hump. And it dies out. And then when it reaches 1, now you have some growth that is possible out of this civilization. But what we in our society now worship is growth. Growth. Every year has got to be bigger and better than the previous year. Well, these are constant year to year over time span. So, and if you kept the R at one level, like 2, it would run forever at 2. But it would never grow, right? Because it would always be that output of 0.5. So in our societies, because we're constantly worshiping growth, we keep finding ways to increase the positive feedback in the system so that we can make it grow. And, you know, you could say metaphorically, you know, this is where we are right now. We're split in so many different ways in our society into layers of people. And we keep pushing it. We haven't learned, we keep pushing it. It gets more complex, splits into 4, 8s, whatever, and then becomes chaotic at about 3.6 something, and then disappears at 4. It goes from 1 to 0. One time period. So we know that in our society we have a positive feedback system, many of them, as a matter of fact. So this is a very simple version of something. Whatever is the real world is a lot more complex than this. But I think there's some lessons to be learned here about what you can do if you're in a situation where you're in this constant growth. You have to turn back the knob on the positive feedback. You've got to stop worshiping growth, or you're going to push the system, the complex system, into an untenable operating area. Does that make sense? And that's all I have to say.
Thank you. Questions for Joe?
The panarchy theory has a very parallel way of saying the same thing.
What theory?
Panarchy theory.
By this label, Roland.
I forget who the other author is. But they basically have looked at complex adaptive systems from cells up through civilizations. And there's a common pattern of growth. And what do you think is getting? A particular level of high integration, high coordination, and drive toward efficiency, then resilience goes down and there's susceptibility to disruption.
Yeah, one other thing I didn't say was that small changes in R, depending upon where you are in that curve, can make huge differences in the output. You know, 0.01 can change when you're in that chaotic area, can have a huge change in the output.
Mm-hmm.
what exactly is a positive definition of positive?
Positive feedback. It just means that you're taking the results of your work and feed it right back into the system again to get more out of it. And the stronger that linkage is, the more positive feedback you have. Most stable systems operate under negative feedback. That's the traditional way of running a system for years, in that when you built any kind of piece of electronics or something, you put control mechanisms in it so that it would limit what the output was. They were negative feedback.
And that's why a stable output.
Yeah, then you get a stable output.
Like most of the machine.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a great example where you have a microphone and a speaker and they start to interact and it just loops and it goes out of control.
If you're making too much growth,
it's not the amount of money. If we were happy living at one level of performance, the system would stay stable for a long time. But because we're not worshiping the amount of money, we're worshiping growth.
More.
It's pushing us toward an unstable civilization. That's the metaphor.
It's interesting, Paul, because you see that played out in the labor market throughout the world, actually, as we've been pushing for higher and higher productivity and pushing people to do more with less, it's having devastating consequences.
Right. And, you know, these little cubby holes in civilization that you were talking about, they're not worshiping growth. They're just sustaining, right? That's sustainability again.
They would like to be going for growth. They just don't have the wherewithal. They're
down in that bottom end, right? They can't get over that hump.
They don't know what they have.
Right.
Yes. Our final speaker is John Rowland. John is founder of the Constitutional Society, a legal historian, and a computer professional, with over 15 years of software design, development, usability, and systems engineering experience. He's lectured on usability, design practices, and internet security. He developed and led software training courses, taught workshops on user interface design, multimedia, and usability, and he's led teams of up to 50 people. His topic today is forecasting the future using computer simulation. Past analyses of fallen civilizations, critique of resource depletion models, and most likely threats. Not only that, but he's going to give us the way forward. Help me in giving a warm welcome.
Thank you, Joyce. We go to the first slide. We have several past analyses of civilizations. And when I say civilization, I mean not just an empire or a country, but an interconnected, interdependent economy and society. In other words, where they're coupled closely enough in their trade and production and so forth that they tend to rise and fall together. And the classic original analysis of this, although there were others before it and since, was the book Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire by Edward Gibbon, about the time that this country was founded. It had a lot of influence on our framers. Gibbon points out that the Roman Empire succumbed to barbarian invasions due to gradual loss of civic virtue. In other words, they were mostly destroyed from without, but they were unable to defend themselves effectively. So the Vandals and so forth overran them. He attributes to the Praetorian Guard as the role of the primary catalyst of initial decay and eventual collapse. In other words, they're police force. They're elite police force. And unfortunately, in his time, Gibbon was not aware of the many other economic, political, and ecological factors that affected and caused the decline of the Roman Empire, such as excessive internal predation, the very economic model of overtaxation, overexploitation, essentially treating the entire population as serfs, except for the citizens of Rome itself. Next slide.
You're scared.
Here we go.
Toy
okay. The next one, more recently, was the classic and influential study of history by Arnold Toynbee. He examines many civilizations, especially the 19 major ones. He also examines a number of others he calls abortive or partial. Egyptian, Andean, Cynic, Minoan, Sumerian, Mayan, Indic, Hittite, Hellenic, Orthodox Christian, Russia, Orthodox Christian main body, that is to say Western Christianity, Persian, Mexican, Yucatec, Babylonic, and the surviving ones, Western, Far Eastern, Hindu, and Arabic Islamic. Each rose, according to Toynbee, by successive responses to challenges that were great enough, but not too great, and fell when stagnated, for either a lack of challenge, or they could not cope with greater challenge. So they needed not only challenges, but a steady rate of challenges that was just right, Goldilocks challenges. Not too warm, not too hot. And when the challenges exceeded that range with which they could cope, the civilizations tended to fall. Now, initially, when the beginning of the civilization, the key is a leadership by creative minorities and not having too many hostile, alienated, external or internal barbarians. In other words, during the early period of the civilization, if they have spent too much of their time fighting against external enemies, they can't really realize their creative potential. So they need a lull in external threats. But those creative minorities tend to become dominant and predatory. They can become less creative. And by the course of that, they tend, historically, to create a universal state. Now, that doesn't really mean the state covering the whole world, but covers most of the region, at least, in which their economy operates. The Roman Empire, of course, being the classic example. However, even if they don't have external enemies, even internal enemies, destructive predators bring disintegration. They can be external, they can be internal. But what usually kills the civilization is this kind of inter-predator competition. So looking at external threats, well, competing civilizations. We now have four survivors, and basically one of them is against the other three, although that may change. We could have alien invasion, either from space aliens or from other parts of this planet. Have refugee floods, just overwhelming border control. And of course, we could have nuclear war. Not necessarily total nuclear war, but even a partial nuclear war could be bad news. If sudden disasters, such as we discussed earlier, volcanoes, impactors, that is to say asteroids, climate, earthquake, disease, celestial, would be things like gamma ray bursters. Most are challenges that could be met with sufficient preparation. So real challenge and threat is lack of preparation. Yes, we could actually survive a gamma ray burst. It is survivable. So most of these, you know, unless the impactor were the size of a, you know, hundreds of miles across, we could probably even survive that. We might have to leave the Earth for a while and come back after it settled, but it could be done. And of course, we can always simply leave the Earth. All surviving civilizations, in other words, the last four survivors, are weak on preparation. Probably only the Western is even thinking about preparation in this area. Then we get to resource depletion challenges. Of course, we have the limits to growth models, which were very famous back in the late 70s and early 80s. We have the more recent paper that provoked this session, what I call the MRK paper, because I don't call it NASA paper. But what they have in common is they ignore alternative of urban biospheres. They assume that people remain scattered across their surface. You can gather people into urban biospheres, which are closed with respect to resources and only use a little bit of energy. And I discussed that in an earlier paper from 1998, I think I wrote it, called Three Futures for Earth. But such an urban biospheres are very expensive on a per capita basis. We're looking at several million dollars per individual. So you're not going to take 7 billion people and put them in urban biospheres in time to save all 7 billion. And of course, that could create problems with the ones you leave out, because they might decide, well, if we can't be saved, we're not going to let you live either. So the limits to growth models is a classic example of a printout of the running of a systems dynamics model. They tended, most of their settings, parameter settings, tended to predict peaks in the 2000 to 2050 period with a population, resources, and industry and all that peaking at about that time and then going into a decline. Now, the MRK paper starts with the predator-prey models, where prey are resources. It examines non-renewable, renewable, and stream resources and the depletion of each. But here's where one of the main ways it goes wrong. It posits wealth-income inequality as a predictor of destructive internal conflict. Now, that can be a problem in some societies, especially less developed ones. But what is missing or not understood by most of this talk you hear now about income or wealth inequality is that, at least in the developed world, the real inequality is not consumption. Wealth and income do not correspond to consumption. The people who have large wealth and great incomes don't consume that much more than the people at the bottom of the heap. They just don't. Even the richest people in the world can only eat so much, can only wear so many clothes, can only drive so many cars, and most of the rest of us can do the same things. So where their inequality comes in power and over making economic decisions, and those who make those decisions don't necessarily make them to the disadvantage of the rest of us. We might not like the fact that they make them in the ways that they do in some cases, but by and large, the market works. So where does the problem arise? Well, it can arise, even in a developed country, if when there is a breakdown, an economic collapse, then the differences in consumption would become important. In other words, after there's a general collapse of the economy, then you have a situation where the elites are still eating and the rest of us are not. And then we have a problem. But at that point, once the economic collapse sets in, the chances are, it doesn't matter, it's going to run to all the way down whether there's conflict or not. Conflict just becomes an aggravator, an amplifier of the process. So we can contemplate urban biospheres. This image represents one design. Basically, they're built underground. Because if you are trying to envelop a city full of people in a way that they do not lose any materials to the environment, you know, the most effective way to do that is to seal them off underground. And if you have them on the surface, they're subject to weathering and other such things, so there'll be a small loss of materials to a high entropy state. And if you do this, you could have a million such cities with a million people in them each, a trillion people, all living quite comfortable lives, using only no more energy than we could get from the sun, some solar collectors. And if for the small losses of materials, we get all we need from the asteroids. A single asteroid, we figure now we've done a spectroscopic survey of one of them, seems to have more precious metal content than has been mined on the Earth throughout history. Wow. One asteroid. So the resources are abundant. They're relatively easily reached, so that's not a problem either. But you can't leave people scattered on the surface trying to dig, you know, to mine the soil for nutrients for their food. Another alternative, of course, is to build them in space. This also provides the opportunity to move the whole city away from the Earth in case the Earth is threatened. But again, the point is that they are self-sufficient with respect to materials. They use relatively little energy, and that could easily be replenished. And you could have huge numbers of them, plenty of resources to build, you know, large numbers of them. Now, there is a problem with space cities in that, for this kind of design, because of cosmic radiation, you almost certainly need to actually build them inside of asteroids, because you need a certain amount of sheer bulk shielding in order to keep them from being fried over a period of time. So main threats to modern civilization. Well, we have to lump Far Eastern Hindu with Western, because right now they are so coupled economically that, and even culturally now, that they're really becoming one civilization. Islamic is on an uncertain course, although it is becoming integrated with Western civilization, most of them. It still has the strong, what I call, Khalifist movement. These terrorists, you know, the people come to call them Islamists or jihadists or whatever. The better word for it is Khalifism, because that it identifies them as having a political agenda. In other words, the formation of a universal state headed by a caliph. And this guy, the leader of this ISIS, this Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, has renamed himself Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. It's not his name at birth. Abu Bakr was the first caliph. So he's adopted the mantle of the caliphs. Obviously, that's his ambition. But within our civilization, we have several key threats. One is nonviolent legal predation. Rent seeking is a commonly used term for that. It's legal. Nobody's knocking anyone in the head to take their stuff, at least not, except perhaps using lawyers and policemen to do it, but not directly. Another is unmanageable complexity. We've mentioned that, and Paul actually mentioned it more thoroughly in his talk some time back. Human beings evolved to live to solve the simple problems of a tribe or a village. We have created an economy, a civilization, a technological structure, which is so complex that no one can understand it. A few people can understand parts of it. When you talk about rocket science, no one understands everything you need to know to send men to the Mars and bring them back again. Each one understands one small part of the problem and works on his small part. And if they're not coordinated, you have big mistakes. Things fail, and if they fell between the cracks. But with societies generally, there is no such unitary engineering approach to an entire society, nor could there be, because they're inherently unmanageable. People might imagine they can, and they get into a lot of trouble among themselves and with the rest of us when they try. But that leads to the problem of incompetence. In other words, the fundamental inadequacy of human beings to understand complex systems and to fall back on magical short-term thinking, which I cite one example, the cult of Keynesianism, which has now infected a large part of our policymaking elite and leads them to think that they can go on taxing, borrowing, and spending forever without limit, and that nothing bad will happen if they do. Because, of course, Keynes did not look at running his models to completion, you know, to their limits. He just projected a few years ahead and left it at that. And his followers are projecting many years ahead and not even thinking about the distant future. Okay, we have external barbarians, caliphists, terrorists. Not all terrorists are caliphists. You know, you can have domestic ones too. A disgruntled kid working in his garage to create a new deadly plague or something. But we also have internal barbarians, which I would include general things like lawlessness and malbred children. In societies that have a very tight control over the upbringing of their children, you tend to find very low rates of crime, very high low rates of civic virtue. But if, and usually this happens when they become urbanized, there's a degradation over the quality of child rearing, as a result of which you get a lot of lawless children that become lawless adults. And you can get entire societies where crime is so prevalent that it becomes impossible to do anything else. And all these refugees we get from Central America, well, they're not directly fleeing hunger. Okay? If you ask them why they're coming here, it's because they're mainly fleeing criminal violence. And if they were really so malnourished that they'd be on the edge of starvation, they wouldn't be able to make the trek to the United States. So, but that lawlessness is preventing those countries from creating jobs, from solving the problems of their societies. And that is preventing the people generally from realizing a decent life. We also have the problem of excessive taxing, borrowing, and spending. That has to be limited if it's not. And of course, all the demands are for more taxing, more borrowing, more spending. At least more borrowing and more spending. Eventually, you reach overshoot. There's also a problem with official immunity. If officials cannot be held accountable for their misconduct, then they become a master class, a special kind of elite, in which reduces the rest of us to their servants. Then, of course, we have ignorant, apathetic voters who sometimes think that corrupt criminal officials are cool. And then there is the problem of easy prosperity and addiction to entertainment. We actually have seen this before in various civilizations where people are so prosperous that they become decadent. And we can see that here. Even though most Americans are hardworking people, so many of them are so absorbed in entertainment, in recreation, in idle pursuits, that it is degrading them in a variety of ways, including things like child rearing. So here's a graphic for rent seeking. These are various words that are related to it. Rent-seeking is an economics term, but some of these are more familiar terms, and although it doesn't show how they all interact with each other, these are all different aspects of rent-seeking behavior, which is not new, by the way. In feudal times, the feudal nobles, the warlords, were rent-seeking on their vassals. You know, the problem of unmanageable complexity, this graphic is trivial, okay? Mm-hmm. We really wanted to represent a modern economy or society or whatever, there would be billions of factors like this, all intertwined. Not only beyond the grasp of human beings and human minds, but even not even simulatable on a computer, at least not current computers. Let me turn off my cell phone here. Okay. We have a debt bubble. This simplifies it greatly, but what it essentially shows is that historically debt has oscillated somewhat, and now it is heading off beyond limit. Eventually that collapses, probably fairly soon. And debt includes things like fiat currencies. The dollar bills in your pocket, these are all debts. Okay, this is a debt. And it's not just shares of stock or securities or other financial instruments, complex derivatives. It's all kinds of things that there's no natural check on the growth of them, except collapse. And of course, we have nuclear terrorism. There are at least 40 suitcase nuclear devices that were missing from the Russian inventory. We know that Al-Qaeda and other such collapsed groups have been trying to get a hold of them. There was a report from one terrorist we captured that six or seven of them were brought into the United States by his people through the agency of Latin American smugglers. So far they haven't been set off, but you can just imagine a scenario where suddenly one day we lose a city, and then a couple of weeks later we lose another one, some random city somewhere in the country. No one knows where the next one's going off, and do this every week or two or so until they run out of nukes, maybe 40 of them. So you can imagine the effect that would have on this country or on the world. Of course, they're not planning to confine them to the United States. They want to take out Europe and have Australia and China and a lot of other places. And they imagine, they actually believe that if they did this, that we would surrender to them. So, official immunity, this is a famous quote, this is the way law enforcement people are being taught. It says, don't worry about being held accountable for your misconduct because you have qualified immunity. Of course, as a practical matter, it's almost total immunity. As long as you've got a supervisor who says that, whatever you're doing was part of your job, nobody can touch you. Maybe you can sue the agency that you work for, but you can't do anything to you individually. And chances are nobody will or can. Okay, the way forward. It's too late to avoid global economic collapse. We're about at least 40, maybe 60 years too late. We would have to have made different decisions decades ago. Because there's a very long latency in any intervention in this, these systems. And of course, we wouldn't have known what to do then, and we still don't. But we can prepare to endure, come out with lessons learned and needed reforms. In other words, we face a dark age, but there can be light on the other side of the tunnel. If we're prepared to come out on the other side with the lessons that from it and reforms that are needed to prevent it from happening again. You know, as we sometimes point out that we did learn things from the collapse of the Roman Empire. During the Renaissance, there were a lot of Renaissance scholars who examined the Roman Empire and its fall and tried to learn from that and to correct some of the mistakes that, to avoid some of the same kind of mistakes that were made. And of course, our own country is an example of that. The founders of this country were intense students of previous empires, what went wrong with them and what needed to be done to avoid them. Okay, so we can help one another become good preppers. We can educate for austerity and adversity. We can move towards strict constitutional compliance, without which laws and institutions won't be ready. We can move away from fiat currencies and pay off debt. We can prepare for decades of chaos, not just months. Secure sources of water, food, power, medicine. Secure reliable communications like mesh networking that does not depend on backbones. Organize for mutual defense. Secure reliable, easily maintained transport and hoard barter goods.
What are barter goods?
Well, basically everything that people need to survive.
I see.
It could be rounds of ammunition, it could be cans of food, it could be tools, you know.
Things you can barter with.
Yeah, things you can exchange that people will actually find useful. Gold and silver is probably not good for that purpose, at least not for the first few decades. It would be more important to have rounds of ammunition than bars of gold.
Wow.
Because you can't eat gold.
Yes.
And so here are a few of some of the kind of reforms that are going to be needed, and I have a constitution.org pretty well laid out. People keep reading them and glazing over when they do. It says, ah, but I'm sorry, they're tough. But you either apprehend things at the level of complexity that you need to in order to be effective, or you will not be part of the solution. So finally, epitaph for humanity. They were smart enough to create problems for themselves. They weren't smart enough to solve. Thank you.
Let's give a round of applause to all of our presenters, please. And thank you all for coming.
Can I do a quick survey of people? If you're like me, your head is spinning now between all of this doom and gloom scenario and positive outcomes, and in spite of all this, the amount of violence in the world is being reduced, the amount of poverty in the world is being reduced. So, question for everyone. 2050, let's make a prediction. Average quality of life better or worse than it is now?
For who?
Take your pick, either for the average American or worldwide.
Worldwide, it's easy.
Yeah.
What is it?
Better.
It's better.
Okay.
But average American is not
so. Not so much for us.
Yeah, I would say worse. By 2020, yeah. 2030, probably. But by 2050, no. It's going to fall apart by then.
If not.
I say better.
I say worse.
I see that as when natural resources, not renewable resources, problems start to really hit us.
We're
going to
figure out new ways to solve that problem.
Well, if we can believe, you know, nobody mentioned Peter Diamandis' book, Abundance, right? Nobody mentioned it.
No,
Peter wrote it.
What?
Abundance. Peter Diamandis wrote a book called Abundance, where he posited that technology and human innovation will collaborate to create new systems and processes to solve all of our major challenges. I wish I could be as optimistic as he is.
But of course, he doesn't specify how. And we actually can identify constraints on possible technological developments. For example, the main area of progress since the middle of the 19th century has been in the efficiency of conversion of energy from one form into another. Mm-hmm. The middle of the 19th century was less than 1%. By the beginning of early first third of the 20th century, we had gotten up to about 20%, and now we're approaching 30. But we're not going to reach 100, and we're not going to reach a 30-fold increase. So most of the potential for improvement along that line has been realized. That mine has been largely played out. So technology is the exploitation of opportunities, but none of those opportunities are unlimited. And we do have more opportunities ahead of us, but they're not necessarily in the direction that provides relief for all of our problems, at least not easily. Like getting minerals from asteroids. Well, you got to get to the asteroids.
And for those of you who, as I sent out the little thing there, handed up, want to know about protecting against increasing sophisticated terrorist attacks, next Friday at TAG. It's going to be on the it's kind of on the biotech scene. So,
I have to say that I think what's going to save the world, I think what's going to be the change, and who knows, maybe it won't happen, but I think that the growth of social entrepreneurship and the fact that youth are grabbing hold of that and running with it, that is going to make the difference.
Well, personally, I don't think that far ahead, 2050, maybe 2030 or something like that. But I still see, I did some traveling last few years. I still see a lot of natural resources that we have not explored, like the deep sea, the mountains. People can live in the mountain if we improve our transportation system. You don't have to live in flatlands. So there are a lot of mountain resources they can use, the forest, the mineral, the water, the collection, all the system. You can improve the transportation system.
Witness Nepal.
I think there's still a lot to explore. Even China, they say they're all population, but there's still a lot of land that are not being used. But they're mountains, they're hard to reach. But they improve the transportation system, they can do it. They try to build more cities right now, that's the current policy. But they don't want to think about using the current resource to let people live by themselves.
To me, one of the most amazing and underreported stories of this spring, it happened right here in Austin, is that the Austin Electric Company signed a contract to get solar power cheaper than wind, cheaper than gas, and cheaper than coal.
Wow.
That happened this spring.
Oh. The electric car is now, I think, on the edge of taking, you know, I helped my nine-year-old do this report on electric cars, and we went down and looked at the Tesla and all of that kind of stuff. We've gotten so used to plugging in our phones that the electricity, and this guy, Elon Musk. He is, their changes are coming.
Yes.
They're coming. So, I mean, there's optimism. I think there's optimistic things out there.
There's one technology we didn't talk about tonight that I think is far away more optimistic than almost anything else I've seen. and I wouldn't be so high in it, except I really read his book carefully. Eric Drexler, who, as you know, was the prophet of nanotechnology, has a new book about atomically precise manufacturing. By 2025, 2030, if things continue to go. And of course, the big variable is whether the economy stays put long enough so this thing can happen. But as I started looking at the details of the development curve, even if the overall economy doesn't stay together, if there's enough pocketed economy that can keep that developing, and then really work for the highly developed nations first, but that has some very positive things.
And we're going to land on Mars in the next 30, 40 years, so maybe we can just create a society there.
And by the way, one problem with the MK case study, when they say non-workers, the elites consume almost nothing. It's insignificant. Most of those non-workers are children, the aged, the sick, and the congenitally unemployable.
That's me.
And some rich people.
Yeah. Well, most rich people actually do work. There are a few idle ones, but most of them are actually productive people.
I found about the second generation or third generation of these people.
Yeah.
They don't work.
You can add college students to that too, I think.
Yeah. Well, thank you for
Well, thank you, everybody.
Thanks for all our speakers.